Good morning, children.
Good morning,
ma'am.
How are you all?
Good morning,
ma'am.
Fine, ma'am.
Okay. All right.
How are you, ma'am?
I'm doing well. Thank you. So happy to see you. Only once in a week I get this chance. Okay. I can see you all on the screen. But anyway, so the last class I had given you homework.
Yes.
Only yes, few of you sent it to me. What happened to others?
Ma'am, I did it, but I didn't send it to you.
Okay.
Yeah, me too.
I have asked
ma'am,
you to send it to me, right?
No, ma'am, you told to show us in the next class, right?
Yeah.
Ma'am.
Anyway, are you ready with that?
Yes.
Yes,
all
ma'am.
Of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, towards the end of the session,
ma'am.
I'll ask.
Ma'am. Okay. Ma'am.
Yes. Somebody is calling me. What's the matter? Okay, so shall we begin the poem?
Yes, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
In the last class, we discussed about the poetess. What is the name of our poetess?
Michaela Morgan.
Michaela Morgan is a famous poet and author. She writes mainly for children.
Picture story.
Her poem, Blake's Tiger Revisited, is based on whose poem?
William Blake's poem,
The Tiger. In William Blake's poem, The Tiger, tiger is portrayed as a majestic and fiery hunter. But in this poem, we find that the tragic flight of a tiger. Yes?
The tiger is in a cage.
Yes. In this poem, we find the extremely opposite situation. The poetess is portraying the tragic plight of a tiger. We can see the anguish.
So what was the name of the poem by William Blake?
Tiger.
The Tiger.
Okay.
T-Y-G-E-R. Okay. That's the name of William Blake's poem, The Tiger. So in this poem, we find that the tiger is helpless. He's feeling bored. He's frustrated. He's depressed because he's behind the bars. So I want Parvati to read.
Yes, ma'am. Tigers that are kept as prisoners in cages can gradually lose their color. They lose their beautiful stripes and fade gradually to white.
Okay. Next. Isa?
Yes, ma'am.
Read the first stanza of the poem.
Tiger, turning white in a cage, just twice your height. Six paces left, six paces right. A long, slow day, a longer night.
Okay, next stanza by Sriram.
Tiger, tiger, dreaming still of the scent, the chase, the kill. And now, no need, no place, no score, no space, no point, no hope.
Okay, third stanza. Lakshmi?
Tiger, tiger, paces, paces. Once he flashed through open spaces, his word one echoed to his rose. Now he's quiet, he stares, he snores.
Okay, last stanza by Ayan.
Ma'am, can you share the screen?
Louder, louder. Ayan?
Ma'am, can you share the screen?
Can you say that?
Share the screen.
Oh, you don't have the textbook?
Ma'am, it is in somewhere. Ma'am, it is in my shelf.
Oh, it is in that shelf. That excuse cannot be accepted. If you come to the class, you have to be ready with your textbook and notebook. Albert?
An image of sky. The path.
A puddle. Concrete.
Concrete. Smells of car. He sniffs the air. He slumps his sight and he stares through
jaundiced eyes.
Yes.
Okay. Ayan, go and get your textbook fast and come. All right. So I'm going to recite the poem for you. Just listen. Okay, first a small introduction is given. Tigers that are kept as prisoners in cages can gradually lose their color. They lose their beautiful stripes and fade gradually to white. So do you remember the images that I showed you in the last class?
Yes,
beautiful images of tiger. It is yellow in color and it has got black stripes.
And then only tiger will become white.
Yes.
How tiger becomes white?
White in the sense is not completely becoming white. It will lose the glossy. The glossy pattern of its body will be lost. Okay, the fur of the tiger will become dull in color. That's what it meant. Okay, it's not completely turning into white. It will become dull in color. Okay. Tiger, turning white in a cage just twice your height. Six paces left, six paces right. A long, slow day, a longer night. Tiger, dreaming still of the scent, the chase, the kill. And now, no need, no place, no scope, no space, no point, no hope. Tiger, paces. Once he flashed through open spaces. His world once echoed to his roars. Now he's quiet. He stares, he snows. An inch of sky glimpsed through the bars. A puddle, concrete, smells of cars. He sniffs the air, he slumps, he sighs, and stares through jaundiced eyes. Okay? It's a beautiful poem. Written with a lot of inner meaning. The poem consists of just four stanzas, each stanza consisting of four lines. Okay, so let's go into the poem. Let's go into the explanation of each and every line. So what is the word that is repeated throughout the poem? Can anyone point it out?
Tiger.
Yes, tiger. The poet is repeating the word tiger. In how many stanzas?
Three stanzas.
In three stanzas. What is the purpose of this repetition? Why is she repeating? Is it because she does not have any words to put into the poem?
Bring us stress.
She's describing about the tiger.
What is the? What
she's
is
doing
the?
Like she's talking to the tiger.
Is that?
I mean, it's like she's doing a conversation with the tiger.
Is it actually a conversation?
No, she's just like saying a tiger how it's just inside the cage.
The central character in the poem, or the main character in our poem, is tiger. She wants to emphasize the central character. That is why the word tiger is repeated. Okay, tiger, turning white in a cage just twice your height. So the poetess tells that when the tiger is imprisoned inside a cage for a long period of time, it will lose the luster of his skin. Luster means shining of the skin will be lost. The skin or the color of its body becomes dull gradually. In a cage just twice your height. Do you think that the cage has got enough space?
No.
So how do you understand? The cage is a small one. How do you understand the cage is a small one?
It is just twice your height.
We know that tiger is huge in size and the cage is just enough to fit him. The cage is just accurately enough to fit him. In a cage, just twice your height. Six paces left, six paces right. Paces means the distance you move in one step. So the tiger does not have enough space to move within the cage. By the time he takes six paces to the right and six paces to the left, the space is no more. Okay, there is no enough space inside the cage. A long, slow day, a longer night. In the last class, we discussed the same, isn't it? Only if we are engaged in certain activities, we feel that the time passes quickly. But then if we do not have anything to do, we'll be bored and it will be a wastage of time. So for the tiger, the day is very long and it is very slow. Why?
Can you repeat it? I was not there because of the connection problem.
Yes, I will repeat, don't worry. Yes. So why the tiger feels that the day is long and slow?
Because he has no action.
Yeah, he's bored.
Why the tiger feels that the day is long and slow?
Because it doesn't have anything to do. It's simply sitting by the cage.
Yes, it doesn't have anything to do. The full freedom of the tiger is restricted inside a cage. And the night is also longer because as it does not have anything to do inside the cage during the daytime, maybe it keeps on. What does it do inside the cage? It sleeps and it eats. So that is something that the tiger does all the time. So in the daytime, the sleeping and eating is over. And what shall he do at night? That's the question. So the day is long and slow and the night is longer than the day. Okay, so the first stanza, the poet is emphasize the fact that when the tiger is imprisoned in the cage for a long time, it gradually loses the luster of his body. Okay, the color will be faded very slowly. And the tiger is inside the cage, which is just twice its height. It does not have enough space to move about freely. By the time it takes 6 paces to the right and 6 paces to the left, the entire space is consumed. And for the tiger, the day remains long and slow and the night remains much more longer. Is the first stanza clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, shall we move to the second stanza?
Yes, ma'am.
Tiger, tiger, dreaming still of the scent, the chase, the kill. And now, no need, no place, no scope, no space, no point, no hope. So, in fact, we have to appreciate the poetic skill or the literary skill of the poetess, because within the limited words, she is able to convey what she means. Look at the words, no need, no place, no scope, no space, no point, no hope. These are not written in lengthy sentences, but two words are put together. In small phrases, she is able to convey what she wants to. Tiger, tiger, dreaming still of the scent. What do you mean by scent here, Anusha?
The smell of his prey.
Yes, Anusha?
The smell of its prey.
The smell of its prey. We know that animals have a good capacity to smell. They sniff. So they smell and they get an idea whether their prey are nearby or not. So are you still dreaming of the scent of your prey? The chase. Remember the picture that I showed you in the previous class? The tiger is chasing the deer.
Deer.
Okay. So it's in fact, it's a matter of their survival. Do you agree with me?
Yes.
It's the law of nature. They have to hunt, they have to chase, they have to kill, and they have to find their food. So I would say that animals are better than human beings, right? Yes, of course.
Yes.
Because they do not harm the living creatures around them for any other purpose, only because they want to survive. The tiger, the lion, the wolf, all these kinds of wild animals wanted to survive. And that is why they chase the other animals, they kill and eat. But what about us humans? We are so cruel, right? We are so selfish. For no reason, we kill each other. That is the difference between animals and human beings. So the author is asking, are you dreaming about the scent, the chase, the kill? So it was all a matter of survival for the tiger. The tiger gets the smell of its prey and then he hides somewhere behind the trees or behind the leaves or behind the grass. Then once the prey is nearby, it starts chasing it. Definitely the deer will not stand there still and it will not say, come, come, come and eat me. No. there will be a fantastic chase happening, and then finally the tiger would kill its prey. And now, so what is the situation now? Is there any difference in the situation?
Yes.
Yes,
of course, a great difference. There is a great difference. No need. So the poetess tells tiger, there is no need of dreaming. Absolutely pointless. No place. There is no place for you. You are enclosed inside the cage. You are enclosed within the walls of the cage. No place, no scope. There is no opportunity for you to go out and hunt. No space, no point, no hope. So all these words suggest that the tiger is in a helpless situation. He's in a frustrated state. He's feeling so bored. And he thinks that his life is just slipping away because he's imprisoned in a cage. So, that's, I think that is Heza.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, the name
ma'am,
here
some,
is different.
Yeah, ma'am, some okay, problems, that's why I was late. That.
Yes, Heza.
Ma'am, some problems was there for network, so I was late.
Okay, that's okay. Johane, tell me, is the cage for the tiger is big enough to walk comfortably? Is the cage for tiger is big enough to walk comfortably? Johane, can you hear me?
No.
Gokul?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Is the cage is big enough for the tiger to walk comfortably?
No.
How do you know? Can you pick out the lines from the poem that shows that the cage is small enough? Quickly.
Ma'am, in a cage, just twice your height.
Yes.
Six paces left, six paces right.
All right. Then from the second stanza?
No space.
Tanmay, from the second stanza, can you pick out the phrases that shows there is no enough space inside the cage? Tanmay?
Yes, ma'am.
Did you get the words?
Yes.
Give me the answer.
And now, no need, no place, no scope, no space.
The words, no place, no space. That shows that there is no enough space inside the cage. Just mark those terms, okay? The first answer, a cage just twice its height. Six spaces left, six spaces right. And the second stanza, the phrase is no place, no space. All these phrases and lines suggest that the tiger does not have enough space to move about in the cage. Okay, I hope the second stanza is clear to you. Any doubts?
Yes, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Shall we move to the third stanza?
Yes, ma'am.
Tiger, paces. Once he flashed through open spaces. His world once echoed to his roars. Now he's quiet. He stares, he snores. So again, the poetess is making a comparative study of the tiger when he was in the wild and now when he is inside the cage. Tiger, paces. The word is repeated twice. Space. Space means the distance that you move in one step. Okay. And why is the poet, why has the poet repeated the term? Paces. Ishel, can you tell me why the poet has repeated the word paces?
Because she is expressing his feeling that the tiger cannot move.
Lakshmi, I can't hear you properly. Be louder.
She is expressing the feeling of the tiger that the tiger cannot move towards.
Okay, she is trying to express the feelings of tiger that it cannot move. All right. Ishel, do you have any other answer? The same. Okay, Hanan.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, the second paces, they mean that he is very bored and going to one direction.
Yes. Okay. Have you seen people walking to the right and left quickly?
Yes, ma'am.
At least in the movies you might have seen. When does a person walk like that?
When he's
when they are tense, when they are frustrated, when they are irritated, when they are bored.
Bored. Okay.
Hurry.
Yes, the people walk to the right and to the left because they are not in a good state. Restlessness, that is what it shows. Okay, complete restlessness. So the same thing is happening to tiger. Tiger, paces. So during the daytime, the entire time, the tiger does not have to do anything and he just walks to the right and to the left. And you can imagine how small the cage is, how small his living space is. So he is feeling so irritated, so bored, so frustrated. He's stressed and he's restless also. Once he flashed through open spaces, there was a time when he enjoyed unlimited space in the wild. He had the full freedom to go to anywhere else as he wished. Once. The poet says that once he flashed through open spaces. Flash means to move quickly.
Okay.
Yes. So there was a time when he had the full freedom to move around as he wished through open spaces. His world once echoed to his roars. What is roaring?
Ma'am, that forest, when he roar, it will echo in that forest.
The roaring sound, the loud, long cry made by a wild animal. Loud, long cry made by a wild animal. Any mimicry artists are there in my class? Somebody who can make the roaring sound of the tiger? Huh? Yes.
And,
any experts, any mimicry artists here in my class? Somebody who can make the sound, roaring sound of the tiger? Yes, Anthony, will you give it a try? No.
Ma'am, somebody is giving.
It's a sound.
It should not be just like a cat. Meow. It should not be like that.
It's giving a big sound.
Oh, who is giving a big sound?
Pranav.
Where is Pranav? Let me find him out. Now, where are you?
Someone is giving pigs a sound.
All right.
Google.
All right. So, do you remember the movie?
Lion King.
Huh? In that, there is a scene where Simba.
Last scene.
Last scene.
It was just trying to make a sound. It was just trying to terrify the hyenas. So at that time when he makes the sound, it was so feeble, and then suddenly grabbing all the energy, it just gives a big roar. Huh?
Ma'am, but it was a roar by his father.
Yeah.
Actually. Second. Yes.
Yes, it was a roar given by his father.
At the same time.
At the same time, exactly. What you said is correct. Okay, so that is what you mean by roar. So his world once echoed to his roar. So if the tiger or the lion roars in the middle of the forest, it will be heard all outside. The entire forest would shiver with the roaring sound of the tiger. Now he's quiet. He stares. He snores. He has become dumb. He has become noiseless. He has muted himself. No more voice is coming out. And even if he roars, nothing is going to happen. Nobody will be frightened after listening to his roaring sound. He stares. He just keeps on staring at the outside world through the bars of the cage. He snores. When he sleeps, he makes a snoring sound. So the poet is asking, should the tiger dream about its life, its earlier life? Is there any use Is there any use? Malavika, the poetess is asking whether the tiger should dream about its early life. Why or why not? Malavika?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. In your opinion, what do you think? Should the tiger dream about? Krishna Kripa?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. The answer to my question. The poet is asking whether the tiger should dream about its early life. Why or why not? Usually memories makes us so sad. Am I right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
If we have experienced a very good life, a very good living situation at one point of time, and right now when we are facing just the opposite, all the memories that comes to our mind makes us so sad. But is there any point dreaming about the past?
No, ma'am.
No. No.
Why?
Ma'am, because there is no use.
Yes. So sad.
There is no use. Because thinking about the past just makes us sad. It makes us so worried. It makes us depressed. So the same thing, the poet is asking the tiger, is there any use for you to dream of your early life? You enjoyed all the freedom in the wild life, but now the situation is very different. You are inside the cage. So there is no point in dreaming about your early life. It makes you very sad. It's useless and it adds to your misery. Shall we move to the fourth stanza, the final stanza of the poem?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Any doubts regarding the three stanzas?
No, ma'am.
Oh, ma'am, you are not asking the homework.
All right. An inch sky glints through the bars. A puddle, concrete, smells of cars. He sniffs the air, he slumps, he sighs, and stares through jaundiced eyes. An inch sky glimpsed through the bars. Glimpse means to see something for a short period of time, for a moment. You will not get a complete sight of it.
View.
That is what you mean by glimpse.
Glimpsed.
My friend glimpsed at me as I passed through the corridor. Okay, glimpse. To see something for a moment, but you are not getting a complete sight. An inch of sky glimpsed through the bars. The tiger is not able to enjoy. The tiger is not able to see or view the entire sky as he used to in the earlier times. Now he could see a very small part of the sky. He's inside the cage. He's behind the bars. He's enclosed within the four walls. And he could only see a bit of sky through the bars. A puddle, concrete, smells of cars. Puddle. What is puddle?
And that line thing in that cage.
Line thing in that cage? Huh?
Iron
road. Lines are called as bars.
Ma'am, iron road in that thing.
Bars are iron roads. What is puddle? Puddle means a small pool of water. Okay?
Muddy puddle.
Pool of water. Especially when it is raining time, we can see small puddles forming here and there.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
But here the puddle means artificially created puddle. Okay. A small pool of water will be created at the corner of the cage so that the tiger, if the tiger feels thirsty, it can go and drink water. Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
What do you mean by puddle? A puddle, concrete, smells of cars. So how was the cage of the tiger made?
Concrete.
You know what is concrete? Yeah, a mixture of sand, cement, water, everything to make it a solid substance. So a puddle, concrete. The cage is made of concrete. It was made of wood or other kind of substances. Definitely the tiger would easily go out of it. So the cage is made of concrete and smells of cars. What do you mean by that? Smells of cars.
Pollution.
Okay.
Pollution. Will come to zoo.
High thinking capacity. Very good. I did not think about it actually. Okay. Pollution. But smells of cars. The tiger is able to get the smell of cars.
Petroleum.
Hmm? Ma'am, in the zoo and all humans come, so
yes,
that
yes,
exactly.
Cars. Exactly. The tiger's cage is inside the zoo. And every now and then he gets visitors. He's frequently visited by the spectators. Okay, so he could get the smell of cars. He sniffs the air. He slumps. He sighs. He sniffs the air. He could get the smell of the air. The air is polluted, of course. In the forest, it is different. Pure water, pure air, everything is pure in the forest. But in the town, in the city, the situation is different. Because the air is polluted with many number of vehicles. So he sniffs the air. He gets the bad smell of air. He slumps. Okay, he bends his head and shoulders forward or down because he is very tired and unhappy.
Unhappy.
He sighs. He takes deep breath to show that he is helpless. The situation shows his complete helplessness. And stares and stares through jaundiced eyes. Jaundiced eyes. Why the poet has used the term jaundiced eyes?
What bad people. He sees
he
bad people with his eyes.
The people.
Okay, okay, I agree. The meaning is given in the text like that. What do you mean by jaundice?
Yellow.
Huh? Any idea?
Yellow.
Huh?
In a crooked manner.
No.
Sad.
Ma'am.
Sad.
Very angry. Angry. Eyes. Angry.
I'm just asking you about the word jaundice. Jaundice, it's a disease. Okay, jaundice is a disease characterized by yellowish pigmentation on your skin, your nails, and your eyes, caused by the.
Ma'am, Carolyn told that.
Yes, Carolyn, your voice was not audible for me. Okay, all right. Anyway, good. So jaundice is a disease characterized by the yellow pigmentation on your skin, your nails, and your eyes. Everything remains yellow in color. So a person who is affected with jaundice, whatever he see, he see it in yellow color. Okay, so the poetess concludes the poem by telling that he stares and stares. He looks out of the world. He looks the outer world with the jaundiced eyes. He thinks that the people in the world is completely bad. And that is why he has to go through such a situation. Okay, so is the poem clear to you? We have come to the end of our poem. Any doubts?
No, ma'am.
Okay. So I want you to read the poem at least thrice. Okay? Okay, five times.
Ma'am.
If you read it 5 times, that's very good. Okay? Read the poem and I'll be sending you the questions. Write the answers in your notebook. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, children. I'll see you in the next
class. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.